Okay, last time we talked about the second fundamental theorem of calculus. And that said that if big F is an antiderivative of little f, in other words, if the derivative of big F is little f, then computing definite integrals of little f is easy. To get the definite integral from A to B, you just apply big F at the endpoints. That's really useful because the definition of this is the limit of a sum, and it can get really, really ugly. Finding an antiderivative and plugging it in is much, much easier. But that brings up the question, how do you know that there is an antiderivative? And if there is, how can you find it? So, that brings us to the first fundamental theorem of calculus. The first fundamental theorem of calculus says that every continuous function has an antiderivative. And in fact, the indefinite integral is that antiderivative. So it says, if you compute the indefinite integral, and then take the derivative of the indefinite integral, you get back the original function. Okay, so let's look at a picture of what's going on. Let's suppose we've got our function f. Here's our function y equals f of s. Here's our variable s. We start at a certain point a, and then we say we'll define the function I of x is the integral from a to x of f of s ds. In other words, if you pick a value x, then I of x is all the area under the curve between a and x. Okay, great, it's a function. If you change the value of that function, you make x a little bit bigger, you pick up some extra area. You pick up this region. If you make x smaller, you lose some area. So I of x is the total accumulated area as you sweep out starting from a until you get to x. So let's go ahead and see if we can take the derivative of this. And we're not going to use any of our derivative formulas like the derivative of x cubed or the chain rule or the product rule or the quotient rule. We're going to go back to the definition of the derivative. The derivative of I of x is the limit as h goes to 0 of I of x plus h minus I of x divided by h. So let's draw the point x plus h here and see what is I of x plus h. Well, I of x plus h is all the area from a to x plus h. And I of x is all the area from a to x. So the difference is all of the area between x and x plus h. In other words, it's the integral from x to x plus h of f of s ds. And we're dividing everything through by h. So, how big is this area? Well, it's roughly a rectangle. You know, it's a little shorter than that rectangle. It's a little bigger than that rectangle. But it's roughly a rectangle. And the width of that rectangle is h. So if you take the area of this region and divide by h, what you're really doing is taking the average height. And you're averaging between x and x plus h. So the height, it's not exactly constant. Here it's a little bit bigger than that here. But if you take a very small value of h and you look only in this really small region, then the height doesn't change much at all. In fact, as long as the function is continuous, as you make this thinner and thinner and thinner and thinner, you get less and less and less wiggle room about how high the function is. And so the limit is the actual height at the point x. In other words, the limit is f of x. So we have just proved that half of the fundamental theorem of calculus. Okay, So what's the big deal? Now that we've proved it, what can you do with it? Well, one thing is we've got three different notions, remember? We have the definite integral, is the integral from a to b of f of x dx, which is the same as the integral from a to b of f of s ds, doesn't matter what we call the variable. We have our indefinite integral, which is the integral from a to x of f of s ds. And we've got our antiderivative. Which we called big F of x. Now the point is we just showed that the indefinite integral is an antiderivative. And for that matter, any antiderivative is an indefinite integral. See, all antiderivatives are the same. They're all the same up to a constant. And the same way, all indefinite integrals are the same. See, if we change the value of a, if we start at a over here, then we would pick up some extra area. That would add a constant to I of x. Different choices of a are like adding constants to f of x. So in fact, the notation that people often use is they will use integral of f of x dx. And they will call this an indefinite integral. But usually what they mean is that they're looking for an antiderivative. It's bad terminology. An indefinite integral really means this. But when you see this notation in books, as often as not, people are just talking about antiderivatives because we've just shown indefinite integrals are antiderivatives are indefinite integrals.